What are birds? We just don't know. So this is Archaeopteryx, typically thought of as the first bird. So what group is it a part of?
Well, typically, Archaeopteryx is considered a member of this group, Avalae, which is usually used as the group that is all birds. Except there's a problem. Archaeopteryx couldn't fly. So, is it a bird? Is it not a bird? Oh, we have a problem now, don't we?
What is then the smallest possible group that we could use as birds? What is definitely all birds, no doubt. Nothing in that group could possibly not be a bird. We're talking the most conservative group.
Well, it's this one, Neornithes. That is the group that contains modern birds, all of them, and their most recent common ancestor. Note that it doesn't include Archaeopteryx. Oh no. And, you know, besides that, it also doesn't include quite a few other things. Like this guy. This is the Hesperornis. It's not in Neornithes, but pretty much everyone calls it bird because it looks like a bird. It basically looks like a crane with teeth. But it wasn't. It was Hesperornis. But it's not in Neornithes, which makes it not a bird. So, that's clearly not true. So then what's our new definition of bird?
Well, I guess Ornithurae is as good as any definition. But you know, let's just investigate this further again, shall we? See this group whose name I'm not even gonna try to pronounce? It includes this upcoming image. That guy. Yeah. Do you see that guy? Do you see how it kinda looks like a bird? It's not an Ornithurae. We're screwed. Our definition's been fucked up again. God damn it.
Nyah. Alright, let's just go with the Ornithes. Includes that thing, includes Hesperornis, includes all modern birds. But here's the thing. We could do this all day. I could show you lots of different dinosaurs that are in Avalae but not in Ornithes, and they would look like birds to you. This could go on forever. So let's go back and look at why we scrapped Archaeopteryx in the first place. That's right, it couldn't achieve powered flight. So what's the smallest group of dinosaurs that definitely could fly? What is the most conservative flying clade? What is it? Well, it's this, Ornithothoraces. I probably pronounced that wrong. Hakuna Matata. But actually, that's definitely the group that includes all the birds that could achieve powered flight, means on their own steam. They flew on their own, no gliding. I mean, they could glide, okay. Look, they had the ability to fly on their own, but it's a little bit weird because this group, Enantiornithes, yeah, it had powered flight, but there's a question of whether or not it evolved it separately, as in the common ancestor to Enantiornithes and Eornithes didn't fly, and both groups just evolved it on their own, twice, separately. Not the same type of flight evolved. Well, crap. What do we assume that the most recent common ancestor both could fly, and we hope to God that that assumption isn't disproven because we've just destroyed our definition of bird as all flying dinosaurs. But, you know, I'm just gonna indulge something again here. Come with me on an adventure. You see this guy? This is Confuciornis. I definitely pronounced that wrong. Do not use me as a model for pronouncing that word, or any word, ever. That's a good guide for life. Don't use me as a model for how to pronounce words. Anyway, see this guy? Couldn't fly on its own. It's definitely gliding there. Didn't have the right musculature. But looks like a bird. I always call Confuciornis a bird. And I mean, plenty of modern birds don't fly, like emus and ostriches and penguins. Confuciornis could glide, which is more than them. I mean, you could define birds as the group of animals that
are dinosaurs and are all the descendants of the most recent common ancestor that could fly on its own, and some secondarily lost it. But then you're, you know, excluding things like Confuciornis that almost could fly and looked like a frickin' bird. So maybe we shouldn't use flying as our definition. Maybe. So what do we use instead? Well, what is one thing that every bird, whether it flies or not, has in common? What is that one thing that we use as, you know, the definition of verb in everyday life? You know, what is the complementary word in the phrase fur and blank? That's right, feathers. But for feathers, we need a new diagram. Let's do it! Well, here's Abelae, and here's the group Abelae is a part of. That's right. You frickin' guessed it. Dinosaurs. So, why are we looking at dinosaurs and not Abelae again to see where the evidence is for organisms that had feathers? Well, if you've been following my blog for a while, you know that quite a few dinosaurs had feathers, and they weren't in Abelae. Let's look and see which groups have dinosaurs with feathers in them together. Yay!
Hold on to your butts, though.
Troodontidae, Dromaeosauridae, Oviraptorosauria, Therizinosauria, Alvarosauria, Ornithomimosauria, Pompsognathidae, Tyrannosauroidea, yes, that Tyrannosauroidea, the group with Tyrannosaurus rex. Carnosauria even has one. A concave venator was found with protofeathers on its arms. I mean, there weren't a lot of them, but it was a carnosaur, and it had protofeathers. And you see, there are feather impressions in rocks near tracks that are thought to have been left by Dilophosaurus, which is a type of theropod, not in any of the specific groups that I have listed in this one. So that would mean, for the most part, basal theropoda, if it's really from Dilophosaurus. I don't know, man, it doesn't really matter, because here's the thing. We got feathers in a basal ornithischian, you know, the group not containing birds. Got some protofeathers in Cullandodromaeus, which is a knee ornithischian, so it's not even a basal member of this group. That is definitely not the group with birds. And then we have a Psittacosaurus with quills on its tail. Yup, Psittacosaurus with quills. That's definitely not a theropod. Holy shit. So I guess we're moving our protofeather arrow from Abelae to Dinosauria, since, you know, the two basic groups of dinosaurs, even though one doesn't have birds in it, had feathers in them, meaning that more likely than not, protofeathers were an ancestral condition for Dinosauria and any and all scaled dinosaurs, of which there were quite a few, you know, got their scales secondarily. But there's another problem. I know, right? You're all groaning. I'm groaning. Everyone's groaning. There's a lot of groaning going on. Pterosaurs, the very close cousins of dinosaurs, pretty much all had these things called pycnofibers. They were filamentous structures, kind of looked like fur. In fact, lots of people called them fur. Here's the thing, protofeathers, the things that pretty much all dinosaurs, or the ancestor of dinosaurs anyway, had protofeathers. The thing that evolved into feathers. Yeah, those also look like fur. In fact, pycnofibers and protofeathers, they kind of look really similar. So, you know, what's the more logical explanation that both pterosaurs and dinosaurs managed to evolve very similar structures that were used for very similar things and covered very similar areas of their bodies, or that the most recent common ancestor for both had this structure that if you call it pycnofibers or you call it protofeathers, same frickin' thing. Well, I think you can tell where I stand based on just how I phrased all of that. That means protofeathers and things like it, like pycnofibers, are an ancestral trait for pterosaurs, dinosaurs, and their most recent common ancestor, which is Ornithodira. That group. That's the group. And, you know, then we have a problem, because if we define bird as thing with protofeathers, well, pterosaurs are birds now. Crap. I don't think that that's a good definition. Do you? I mean, go for it if you want, but I literally do not think a single person on the entire planet is gonna agree with you on that one. Let's regroup. Here are Theropods, the group with Abelae, and most of the feathered dinosaurs, if you remember. Now, a really good definition is what animals have complex feathers, the kind that you see on the wings of birds, the kind with the barbs, the kind you make into a quill pen. Pinaceous feathers. What is the clade with pinaceous feathers on their arms as wings? What is that group? Say hello to Peneraptera. Peneraptera is the group of animals that all have those pinaceous wing feathers. But, you know, we have a slight problem again. Yay. There's something really weird with City Patty, an oviraptorosaur. I mean, yes, it had pinaceous feathers on its arms, but here, let me explain. In 2007, a paper came out that was basically using cell size to determine the genome size of extinct organisms, because you can actually do that. Cell size directly correlates with genome size. Now, the paper specifically was looking to see if small genome size was a condition necessary for flight in vertebrates, and actually, both this paper and a later one found that three groups of flying vertebrates, pterosaurs, bats, and birds, all had evolved very small genome sizes. Now, I can wax poetic on this for years, trust me, ask my friends, but the thing is that the group that evolved into birds, if you'll bear with me in that terrible phrasing, the theropods all had really small genome sizes, like this was a condition of that group, except for City Patty, which is listed in this diagram as oviraptor because everyone keeps mixing the two of them up. Don't worry, that doesn't make this any less of a weird thing. Oviraptor, City Patty, what have you, alone out of all the frickin' theropods, had a really frickin' huge genome. Why? We don't know. We don't know why. We have no idea. We don't have no idea if this is even just a thing that was weird about oviraptor and all the other members of the oviraptorosaur group, which was large, had normal genome sizes for theropods, or if this was a condition of that group. We really have no idea. And I wanted to research on it, because seriously, what the hell? So, do we then define birds as all the animals that definitely had their ancestor have a small genome? I don't know, man. I really don't know. I kinda don't like that definition, because the theropods before oviraptorosaurs had small genomes, you just saw. Oviraptorosaurs were weird. So, I mean, you could use that as a definition since small genomes are necessary for flight and, you know, birds fly and it's kind of their thing and all the rest of it. But, I mean, look, man, I just don't think it's that good of a definition. So while there is a bit of an iffiness about including oviraptorosaur in the definition of burb, I think it, a better definition is probably that wing feather thing, since, you know, makes it look like a bird. But we're hit with a moral conundrum. Oviraptorosaurs might not share this kind of important characteristic of birddom, because you need a small genome to fly. Because it makes your whole body more efficient, it makes your cells smaller, makes you more lightweight, I'm not going into that. So Peneraptera or Paraves? Peneraptera? Paraves. Peneraptera? Paraves? Peneraptera or Paraves? I just... Fuck it. This thing looks enough like a bird for me. It's an oviraptorosaur. That thing looks like a bird. It's a frickin' bird. Which means... Look, either way you slice it, whether you say it's Paraves or Peneraptera, Velociraptor, you know, the thing in Jurassic Park that no one ever reconstructs, right, because they think that it could hold its hands like bunnies do and didn't have feathers and was huge, but it actually looks like this picture. Anywho, yeah, that thing is an actual pointy burb. Sweet. So what about this thing, Archaeopteryx, the so-called first bird? Well, it's not a basal member of Peneraptera, and a member of Peneraptera would have had to have evolved before Archaeopteryx could have, because Archaeopteryx was Abelae, and Abelae is a pretty derived group of Peneraptera, which means, sorry Archaeopteryx, guess you aren't the first bird anymore. But at least you are a bird, and that is, in the end, what actually matters. Unless you decide that you want a different definition, in which case that's all up to you, but you know, It's really a matter of semantics, and you have to decide what you think makes a bird, and what makes being a bird, what is fundamental to the existence of bird. And in the end, what are birds? We really just don't know, and that's more than a joke. It's just a statement of fact. Thank you. Hope you learned some stuff. I certainly did. Have a lovely day.